Morning. Nice to see all of your faces. Thank you for joining us here. I'm Pastor Chris. This is First Baptist Church in Cambridge, Maryland. So grateful that you could be here, whether in person or if you're watching on the live stream today. We are celebrating the Lord's Supper today. We're very excited about that, of course. And we want to encourage you, if at all possible, stay with us for our fellowship meal afterward, where we gather and we work on our calling to know and love God in the context of the church, to express our love for God in the way we do community together, loving, committed, sacrificial, intimate. So if you're able, please stick around and get to know folks better. We have, I'm looking at the announcements in the middle panel of your handout, Adult Sunday Schools, 9:15, that's with me, Pastor Chris. We're working right now through the London Baptist Confession of Faith. We're on the Decree of God in Chapter 3. It is a great way to just ramp up your devotional efforts in your calling to know and love your God for the glory of God in Christ. Every Wednesday, barring extenuating circumstances, we're meeting at 6:30 here at the church to also learn the Word. We're working through the divine covenants still. And then we pray together. We pray that the Lord would work in us to change us, that he would flourish his church, that it would reach this community for the glory of God in Christ. We changed the business meeting to April 25th. I just wanted to give you that heads up. We changed it from the 18th to the 25th. It's still at 6:30. It's a Tuesday still. Please be there, members. If at all possible, please be there. Such an important thing. There is a real sense in which member is the highest office in the church, and everyone just plays a role from that foundation. And so we've got to take serious our calling to just be God's church together. So those meetings are very important. I want to mention that, is my lovely wife around? Oh, okay. Would you like to make an announcement for the lambs? So I want to ask everyone to be praying for the lambs. Those of you who know Chance and Madison and their son Kagan, Madison is due to go into labor hopefully any minute now, any day now. Please be praying for them. Danielle, my wife, just wants to make a quick announcement.
Good morning, everyone. Yes, we're excited. Madison is literally, right, Chance, about ready to go into labor. If you see Chance like a little lightning blazing out of here, it's because Madison texted him. So we wanted to bless them with some meals. So there's going to be a sign-up sheet in the on the way out there on the bulletin board. Not tomorrow, but the next Monday, we're going to start meals for them Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 5:30. So 9 meals, try to get them through the first 3 weeks of having their new baby with them, Lord willing. So if anyone is interested in signing up to make a meal for them, they live right here in Cambridge, and that sign-up sheet will be right on the bulletin board on your way out. Thank you.
Thanks, Dee. That is indeed such an important part of our calling to know and love God and express our love in the way we love each other. When people are going through different life phases and things, we're there for each other. We support each other, and we really know each other. So please be praying, and if you can sign up, please do so. So please bow your heads in prayer with me as I invoke the presence of the Lord on his worship service. Lord, you are the sovereign King of glory, both by virtue of your divinity and your heroic deed of coming into the world to conquer your enemies, to save your people. This is all for you. There is no hope without you. There is no church without you. There is no ministry without you. You are three in one. You are Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We thank you that you've given us your Spirit to make us a new creation, and that you live with us in intimate community, working in us, making us your temple. You have given us that great gift, and through that gift of union with you, by the power of your Spirit, all other blessings flow. Please let us be very aware of this reality, that you dwell in us, that you are with us, that we live in your presence. Cause us to grow today. Cause us to sit under the authority of your word, to love your word, to submit to your word, to be ever more aware of your presence with us and conforming to Christ. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Glory to God. In the name of the Father, Son, and Spirit. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning. May we stand together and sing, "All glory, laud, and honor."
Good morning on this beautiful Palm Sunday. Today I am reading from Luke 19, 28 to 40. And when he had said these things, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he drew near to Bethage and Bethany at the mount that is called Olivet, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village in front of you, where on entering you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever yet sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' you shall say this: 'The Lord has need of it.' So those who were sent went away and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owners said to them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' And they said, 'The Lord has need of it.' And they brought it to Jesus, and throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. And as he rode along, they spread their cloaks on the road. As he was drawing near, already on the way down the mount, of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." And he answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out."
Lord, thank you for bringing us together this morning. Thank you for allowing us all to be here to praise you and worship you, Lord. We ask that you do with this tithe your will, Lord, and continue to guide us every day. We love you and praise you. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ladies. That was lovely. On this Palm Sunday, as we remember our Lord. Hello again. So, we are continuing our series in Ephesians. I contemplated the possibility of doing two different sermons to commemorate Palm Sunday and Easter. What I arrived at was the decision to do something unique for Easter, but I thought the passage that God providentially brought us to today in Ephesians fit so well that there was no need to do something different. And why do I say that? I hope, does everyone have a handout? If anyone needs a handout, please raise your hand if you have not gotten a handout. Brothers, could you please make sure that everyone gets a handout? Perhaps if Andy's not able, or Harrison could help, even Chance maybe. So I saw down here there's a few. I want to make sure that everybody has handouts as much as possible, because I'm trying to give outlines of the passages that we do that people might get the most benefit. So it's important. And if you can, take notes. I even bring my pencil up to the pulpit. Always taking notes. Thank you, brothers. We got another hand down here. Perfect. I love that sound of children. I had a brother, a friend once, a pastor who he could not preach if children were crying. He just could not preach. He's the nicest brother in the world, but because it was so distracting to him, he would ask the deacons or ushers to escort people to the cry room. I actually like the sound of children. It doesn't bother me. So I actually want to take a moment to thank the Lord that there are children in our church, because no church can thrive and prosper and be sustainable into the future without every generation. So those are joyous noises to me. I'm very happy to hear them. Anyway, so why did I stick with this passage? Not everyone has an outline. If you look at the idea at the top of the page, I gave sort of a little nutshell idea. Christ fulfills the pattern God set with Moses, the Exodus, the Davidic reign in Jerusalem. You could go on and on. Christ fulfills the pattern set throughout the whole Old Testament. And I titled this, Christ the Ascended, Gift-Giving, Sovereign King. Right? So the idea is, with Palm Sunday, Christ rode in on a donkey fulfilling Zechariah, and his own people, whom had been prepared with the word of God, the oracles of God, the witness of 1,000 years of history, God being with his people in that tabernacle and then temple, and they did not recognize him. He was not the kind of king that they expected. They expected Christ to ride in on a war horse and to overthrow the Romans. Here in Ephesians, we've arrived at a little tiny passage where Paul transitions from talking about our oneness, and you'll see that in the first verse of this passage, 4:7, Ephesians 4:7, he says the word one again. I'm going to read the passage in a moment. And the idea is that he's transitioning from talking about how we're one. There's one faith, one baptism, one Father, one Spirit. There's a unity that he has saved us for and into. But that unity entails Christ being the gift of God to each of us and sovereignly working in through all of us gifts for his purpose. Each individual within the body of Christ, the living temple, has a purpose, has roles, has gifts. And so there's a transition from unity to how does that unity play out with each individual playing a part. And Paul, before he goes headlong into that, from verses 11 to 16, which finish out this passage, in 7 through 10, where we're focused, he stops and he gives the basis of, he alludes to the fact that Christ is able to give gifts to the body. And how is Christ able? Why is Christ able? Because he is the king who has won the right to rule the universe, to lead his people from bondage to victory. So please stand with me as we read the passage, and then we'll dive in to Ephesians 4, 7 through 10. Please stand with me for the reading of God's authoritative, glorious word, Ephesians 4, 7 through 10. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it says, when he ascended on high, this is a quote of Psalm 68, 18. When he ascended on high, he led a host of captives and he gave gifts to men. In saying he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower regions, the earth? He who descended is the one who also ascended far above all the heavens that he might fill all things. You may be seated. May the Lord bless the reading of his glorious word, the preaching of it to our hearts, to our souls, that we might receive it, love it, and submit for his name's sake. Amen. So, number one, the real point of the passage, so I gave you the idea because Paul is quoting the sort of centerpiece of this little passage. Paul is quoting Psalm 68. And when he does that, he's referencing everything that's there in Psalm 68 in a sense. So we're going to look at that. But the main idea is that he is the gift. Christ is the gift to his people. And on that basis, all the other gifts that he gives us, they flow through our union with him. Our gift of salvation is that God gives himself to us in the person of Christ. And all of our gifts flow through him for the sake of the building up of the church, to know and love God, to glorify God as we are his living temple. So really the point, and this is a point everywhere in Scripture in a sense, but the point here, there is no other point here except that Christ is the great gift to us, and he's able to give himself to us and all of the other gifts he gives us for the sake of making us his own temple, because he is the victorious king who first descended to the earth and won the right to ascend to the throne of eternity. So what we're going to do, we're going to look, so verse 7 addresses Christ as the gift. And then we're going to look at verse 8, where Paul dives into the Psalm quote, 68:18, and we're going to think a little bit about all that evokes or calls to our attention, Psalm 68. So I'm saying this in advance so you're prepared to know where we're going to go. And I don't want you to get lost. So we're just very simply, in verse 7, we're going to look at Christ as the gift. And then in verse 8, we're going to dive into Psalm 68 a little bit and contemplate Christ as the glorious king. The one point, he is the gift to us, and we want to be meditating always and always on his majesty as the great king. And we want him to be the king. We want to know what kind of king to expect. So we want to know him. We really want to look deeply into the word to see him in every part of this word of God. And then in verses 9 to 10, we're going to contemplate Paul's deduction or Paul's inference. Paul looks at the fact of Christ fulfilling Psalm 68 as the glorious, victorious king who's able to ascend, who gives gifts, and he deduces, well, if he ascended, it's only because he first descended. And that's what we're going to contemplate in verses 9 through 10. And all throughout, again, we're going to meditate on the majesty of Christ as the victorious king. So let's get started with verse 7. With verse 7. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Now, that could be easily misunderstood. You could think of the measure of Christ's gift, and you could take that with probably some other passages in Scripture and get a little off sideways. You could think of that in terms of, Christ only gives some of himself. He gives us with in part. But the point there is not about Christ giving some to us and more to others. The measure of Christ who is the measure. I think one good way to think of it is, in our sin, we are the measure. In our sin, we are the measure. And by God measuring us against himself, we are judged guilty. He looks at us, he sees our sin, we are judged guilty, we need a Savior. But in his grace, in redeeming us, Christ is the measure. And according to the measure of Christ, we get the fullness of God. Without measure, we get God. We get the Holy Spirit without reserve. The way that we get God gifted to us is by God in us. We have a spiritual union with God through the Holy Spirit gifted to us, who represents Christ to us, who changes our nature. He causes us to be born again. The whole point is about knowing God, having God himself, being reconciled to him, to have peace with him, that we no longer are his enemies, under condemnation, under his wrath. He is the gift to us. And so we have Christ without measure, each one of us. But on the basis of that gift of Christ uniting us to himself through his work, now we have many gifts. And I think the Psalm quote, Paul quoting Psalm 68:18, will help us to understand what is the point of Christ giving gifts to men. What is the point of Christ giving gifts to men? So, if you look with me at Psalm 68, Paul changes the quote a little bit. And this has been a source of great consternation for many scholars. You hear all kinds of interesting theories, speculations. Did Paul not know what he was doing? Is Paul quoting some old Jewish commentary called a Targum? You hear a lot of different speculations. Why is Paul changing the wording here? Let's go back and look at the original text that Paul is quoting from Psalm 68. It says in 68:18, "You ascended on high, leading a host of captives in your train and receiving gifts among men, even among the rebellious, that the Lord God may dwell there." So, but Paul in Ephesians 4:8 says, "When he ascended on high, he led a host of captives and he gave gifts to men." So Paul changes it. He's, instead of it speaking of God in the second person, speaking directly to God in the psalm, Paul now is speaking in the third person of Jesus. Did Paul make a mistake? No, Paul is interpreting. So before we dive into the psalm and try to get a little bit of glory out of it, squeeze some glory out of it, I'm going to explain what Paul's doing there. Why is Paul doing this? Paul is, he's like an exegete there. He's unpacking, he's explaining that psalm to us, the fulfillment of it. So kings would conquer, and then they would have what's called a triumphal procession. A procession is like a parade. They would parade their victory. And so in the train, or sort of the line of their parade, they might have in it, what the people that they conquered. They might also have people following them who are celebrating, praising the king. And there's a great demonstration of his conquest, dominion. And the idea is a conquered peoples would then become very often in the Middle East, and this is common with kings in general in the history of the world, a king would conquer you, And then you would become like a captive to that king. You might become a whole people group, would become like a vassal. You've probably heard that word from studying like medieval Europe in school. A vassal is like a lesser king or a subject. You become captive to that king, and now you are loyal to him. On the basis of him conquering you, asserting his dominion, his authority, and perhaps showing you mercy, you might then become a subject king, a lesser king who owes allegiance to the great king. And all the glory goes to the great king who shows you mercy and generosity to make you his subject, his lesser king. That's the idea pictured in covenants in the scripture often. God makes us his subjects who owe him fealty or loyalty. In particular, though, Psalm 68 is drawing on themes that are important to Ephesians. It's like Paul could have had Psalm 68 in mind the whole time. Psalm 68 is set within several Psalms, 65 through 68, that are blessing God. For what? Victory over his enemies. Victory over his enemies. And in the psalm, you see this pattern of triumphal procession. God leads his people to his holy mountain. Mountains are representative of God's unique presence with his people. People worshipped on high places in the ancient Middle East, ancient Near East. And then, you could break down the pattern of Psalm 68 like this, very, very high level. There's a triumphal procession of the king to his mountain, and then at his mountain, the glorious king who has won the loyalty and the victory over all peoples, the nations then stream to him. They come to him to bring tribute. Particularly, so that pattern, though, then has specifics. There's specifics in the Old Testament that follow that sort of pattern. And the first way that pattern plays out is with God sending Moses to conquer Egypt, to take his people out of Egypt. And he brings them then, so he takes them there in bondage. He takes them from bondage, liberates them, defeats the greatest army on earth handily. He takes them to Mount Sinai, a mountain representing his unique presence with his people. And there he forms them into his people on the basis of his law. He gives the law at Mount Sinai. Well, then you see the pattern continues. He leads them from Sinai, from that mountain, to ultimately to the promised land and the mountain called Mount Zion in Jerusalem, where he would put his temple, his unique presence with his people. And then the final fulfillment of that pattern is God delivering us from sin and leading us to conquer, to take possession of what he's given us. The ultimate fulfillment of the promised land is a new earth, a new heavens and a new earth. And the point of the new heavens and new earth isn't just to have a land, to have a place to live, but to be with God as our conquering, heroic, victorious, glorious king. In that first example of how that pattern works with Moses, that's what Paul is getting at. What he's explaining, think of it this way. God, he conquers Egypt, he takes his people out of Egypt, and then he plunders Egypt. He gives them gifts in terms of all of the riches of Egypt. If you've read the story, you know this. They didn't just leave empty-handed. And that's a picture of him taking us out of bondage to sin in the world. Just like God plundered the Egyptians of their wealth to give to his people gifts, he takes us out of the world. And now, in an initiated form, the whole world belongs to us. One day, we will reign with Christ in a consummate form. The whole world will be ours. But now, in this initiated form, right, in this initiated form, all of our gifts right, from the world, the things that we're, you know, you're able to, you have different gifts. You know, some people are able to work with children. Some people are teachers. Some people are evangelists. Some people have the gift of administration. Some people have a gift of, service, encouragement. We have all kinds of gifts. The people in the world have these kind of gifts too, generally speaking. But Christ has redeemed these through his victory in you. So what happened when God plundered Egypt and gave those riches to his people? They left Egypt with the riches of the Egyptians. What did he do with those? Well, he commanded them to, according to their conscience, to give him gifts, to take the riches that he gave them freely from Egypt, to, according to the way they felt led in their heart, to give those gifts back. Does anybody remember what they were to give those riches for? I'll give you a moment to think about it. They took the wealth of Egypt, and then instead of just taking that wealth for themselves, they used that wealth for something very, very important. The tabernacle, representing the dwelling place of God. They gave those riches, the gold, the precious gems, the fine linen, the materials, the valuable materials. They gave them back to God freely, a free will offering to build the tabernacle. So he gave them gifts. They gave the gifts back to him. And then the ultimate gift, though, that God gives them is pictured in the tabernacle. What is pictured in the tabernacle? What's a tabernacle? It's a tent. It's a moving temple. Representing what? The presence of God with his people. The very thing that we lost in the garden. We lost the presence of God with us. The point of existing is not to work a job, not to feed yourself. Point of everything. You're going to see in the final verse of this passage when it talks about Christ fulfilling all things. The point is never terminates anywhere in the creation. The point is that God is our gift. The tabernacle represents God with his people. God dwelling with his people. Where's the tabernacle now? It became a temple in Jerusalem. As the pattern played out again, they went to Mount Zion in Jerusalem. David built the temple. David plundered the peoples around him. He conquered those peoples for God. He took their riches. He stockpiled them. His son Solomon built the temples. No longer a tabernacle, a moving tent. It was a fixed place, a glorious structure sitting on high on the hill over the city of God's people. What does that represent? God with his people. Where is that temple now? Trick question. What? Where is that temple now? This is important. Right here. Temple's right here. Right here the temple is. So Christ has conquered our enemies. He's plundered Satan. The strong man, as I like to say, is Satan. Christ has his foot on the neck of the strong man, Satan, who was ruling this world. Satan took dominion from Adam, became king, effectively, of the world. We were supposed to be king. Now Christ has come into the world. He's descended into the world, and he's put his foot on the neck of Satan. And I like to go a little further and use some sanctified imagination. He's stuffed like a sweaty gym sock in his mouth. And now Satan can't deceive the nations anymore to stop the gospel from going forward. Jesus is plundering Satan by taking his people from every tribe, tongue, and nation. And out of us, though, right, he's giving us the wealth of this world. All the gifts that we have, all the circumstances that we have, all the opportunities that we have, all the energies that we have, all the relationships that we have been sovereignly appointed to us for use in us building each other up as the temple of God, helping each other to know and love God and to express our love for God in the way we love each other. We are becoming the ever increasingly more mature temple of God, the living temple, chief cornerstone being Christ, the foundation being the doctrine of the apostles, which is not doctrine for the sake of it. It's the truth that reveals the glorious King to us. So we'll love this King. So we'll love this King. So there's a sense in which Christ has conquered us. We were his enemies. And he takes us in a triumphal procession. I have conquered them. But he is a glorious King and Savior. He doesn't flaunt it over us. He doesn't damn us. He has rescued us out of the world. Rescued us out of condemnation, rescued us out of bondage to sin, rescued us out of idolatry. So in the same way that they gave their free will offerings from the riches that God plundered from Egypt, we are to willfully, to choose, to turn right back around the God who saved us, to view everything in our life, in our sphere of influence, and our resources as belonging to him, and to give it as a free will offering, to want to give it, to build up his temple, to magnify his name in the world, to help each other to know him and to love him and to be consistent in sitting under his authority, because his authority shapes who we are. His authority shapes who we are, making us into ever more sincere, mature worshipers, God lovers. It's never more complicated than that. It's just that simple. The only reason why it ever gets complicated is because we're diving into all these details to see his majesty. And you've got to do some thinking to go dive into these details to see his majesty. But it's really simple. Keep it in front of you. The gift is God himself. Keep that in front of you. The gift is God himself. Christ fulfills everything in the Old Testament. He's the greater Moses. He's the greater David. His triumphal procession, taking you from bondage and making you into the temple on the ultimate Mount Zion, that is his glory. He's the fulfillment. He's the point. We want to see him clearly. We want to relish him as the pattern from Egypt to Sinai, Sinai to Mount Zion and Jerusalem, from bondage to sin, to the new heavens and new earth, ultimately. Exodus, that's deliverance, giving of the law to create a people, that's union with Christ. Conquest, that's us participating with him. Do you understand? Just like we were in bondage in Egypt in the heart, we were also delivered and brought on Exodus. And now we're being led in a conquest of God's possession. This world is God's possession. How do we conquest God's possession? Do we do it with swords? Are we going to take over Cambridge and tie up the men and put the women and children to work? How do we conquer? We're the fulfillment. Yeah, someone said preaching the gospel. The sword that we fight with is the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And the way we fight, first, we're clearing out the promised land of the heart. You have to clear out the promised land of your own heart. You have to be committed to this authority, to this sword, to go into the promised land of your heart and take dominion first in your heart. And that means Christ must be Lord. You must get a view, catch a high, high view of his majesty as your king. You must pursue him in this word to know him. That is always the case. That's always the underlying point. There are many, many points made in many, many passages. But the ultimate point in application is to look into the face of God in Christ, to see him as he is, glorious, worth all cost, true treasure. We are to pursue him. The conquest is with the sword of the Spirit, first in your heart and the world. We go forth and we are conquering nations and subjugating nations so they will bring their riches to God for his glory. And we do that not by a real sword or bloodshed. We do that by the preaching of the word, the gospel. And as we go forth and people from every tribe, tongue, and nation are converted, they're conquered, they're brought into the kingdom. Some are judged. Some are slaughtered by the word in the way the word hardens them, and they never want any part of that God revealed in the word. They never see the beauty and majesty. They harden their heart and they hate this word. They hate this gospel. They find it foolish. They find it foolish. You'll see in Psalm 68, God magnifying himself as glorious. It talks about how God has thousands upon thousands of chariots. It reminds us of the story when Elisha was pursued by the Syrian general in Dothan. Anybody remember that story? He was giving visions to give away the Syrian king's plans to attack Israel and plunder them. And so they were very upset. All their plans are being foiled by this prophet who could see the future, who could see into the king's courtroom, the Syrian king's, and could tell the people of Israel what the king of Syria was going to do. And they're very upset with that. So a Syrian general came to get Elisha. He was hauled up in Dothan. And what happened? He stood there. The Syrian army surrounded the city. And Elijah was up on the wall with someone. I forget who it was that he was talking to. And what did Elijah do? Does anybody remember this from Sunday school? Maybe, hopefully, from your reading. He prays that the Lord would open their eyes. And what do they see on the hills? Guess who's surrounded? God's people aren't the ones that are really surrounded. The Syrian army is standing at the wall surrounding the city of Dothan to come get the prophet. And they feel invincible. They think this is a cakewalk. We're going to run right through this city. You send him out or you're done. We will burn this city. We will pillage, plunder, and rape. We'll do whatever we want with this city. But the reality was revealed when Elijah prayed. And what was on those hills behind the Syrian army? The army of God. Thousands. Burning, fiery angels of God. God, the sovereign God who rules the universe. We want to see that glory. And we see it not in the fact, that's just to teach you about his sovereign power. The point isn't to impress you with like divine parlor tricks, like he wants to show you burning, flaming military people. That's not the point. Fiery angels is not the point. The point is that he's the sovereign God of the universe. Christ sits on the throne and he works his sovereign plan, fills all things without having to lift a finger to grab a sword. If he wants to judge you, you will sit in your hardness, and you will reject him. If he wants mercy, he will open your eyes and soften your heart. In every case, he will hold you accountable. He will absolutely hold you accountable. We need to fear him to understand how glorious he is. He is the king. It talks about, and there's a reference, this is always lurking. Genesis 3:15 is always lurking through the whole Old Testament. That's why I bring it up often, because it kind of guides us in understanding the whole story. God promises a conqueror in Genesis 3:15, the first time the gospel is preached. And that conqueror is going to crush the skull of God's enemy. And you see it here again. Verse 21 of Psalm 68. But God will strike the heads of his enemies, the hairy crown of him who walks in his guilty ways. And then a couple verses later, that and this is fulfilled in Christ, that you may strike your feet in their blood, that the tongues of dogs, your dogs may have their portion from the foe. That's not for the lighthearted. God is a conquering divine king, divine warrior. We want to know what kind of glorious king to expect. He's not the pale, frail, frosty white Euro Christ in the portraits in the hallways of many Baptist churches. He is a ferocious lion of a conquering king. He's not munching granolas. He's not a flaky hippie guy. He is a warrior, and his robes are drenched in blood. This is our hero who has defeated sin, death, and Satan to liberate us, the divine conquering king. He walks in their blood. He crushes the head of Satan and walks in his blood. and everyone who stands with Satan. As we come to the end, I want to show you 2 Corinthians 8, 9. So Paul's going with the logic. He's like, wait a second. So for Christ to be able to ascend, to sit at the right hand of majesty and have the authority to work all things together for our good, what did he do? Why does Christ have the ability to give us that gift? Why does Christ have the ability, number one, to give us himself? But then also, he has the ability to work all things for our good. How did that happen? Well, Paul makes a deduction. If he ascended to the throne of glory, something had to happen first before him to do that, before he could do that. 2 Corinthians 8, 9. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, infinitely rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you by his poverty might become rich. He got off the throne of eternity. In Ephesians, when it talks about him emptying himself, doesn't mean that he stopped being God. He got off the throne of eternity and became a pauper, came into the world to become lowly, humbled human with all the weakness and struggle and suffering to do what we did not do, to love God as the majestic, holy, worthy God. He loved God with his whole life. What we owe God, our whole life. He did it. He became poor to make you infinitely rich. And you have infinite riches now in initiated form. But you need to actually pursue your calling to understand that. Because you don't feel rich. You feel like, man, I'm going to a crappy job. Or, you know, I didn't quite retire with all the money I wanted to. Or maybe 2008 wiped you out. Or, you know, you don't feel very rich. You are rich because you have the one thing that's worth all cost. You've been united to God. God has united you to Christ. He's made you his. He's given himself to you. I want to read one other text. John 3:13. This is Jesus speaking in the gospel according to John. John 3:13. Right by the famous John 3:16. No one, this is Jesus, no one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. We are stuck in our natural state between a rock and an infinitely eternal hard place. Stuck between earth and a holy God. Because we failed to love God, we are under the judgment. We're under the sword of God's wrath spiritually. We've been given over to a hardness. We don't love what we should love. We hate God naturally. And no one could deal with that except the one who came from heaven. Only if a man should ascend, if God should ascend to become a man, the God-man, could he rescue us from this plight. By taking on our form, doing what we failed to do, loving God with all of his strength, every fiber of his being, and then becoming our substitute, to die, to take the wrath that we deserve. So he sits now fulfilling all things, as it says in the final verse, verse 10. What does it mean that he fulfills all things? If you want to understand anything in its right frame of axis in the whole world, in your whole life, speaking of, I mean, frame of reference, you need to understand that the whole world is for God to reveal himself in the person and work of Christ, and the pinnacle of which is the cross. And your whole life is meant to be, is a, that you have him as a gift, and you are to return your gift to him in the way you pursue him, to know him and love him in the church. If you want to rightly understand, the reason why I said axis is because I had this picture fly through my head. If you want to rightly understand anything, you want to understand why the earth is spinning on its axis right now, why there's ducks on a pond somewhere or a ripple of water going through a lake, why air is going in and out of your lungs, why the baby's crying, all because God has made the world to magnify himself as the heroic, divine King who conquers our enemy by going to the cross in the most counterintuitive, wild way to die like a criminal. So what's the application? To wrap this up, what is the application? We don't want to be like they were on that Palm Sunday, looking for a different kind of king than the one that's revealed here. We don't want to be looking for that king who's going to come and overthrow Rome and make our life the way we want our life to be. We want to be a people, we know what the king is like, who to expect, because we're busy pursuing our calling to love this God who loved us first. That's the application. We want to pursue him in this word. We want to see him in all of his majesty as the divine conqueror, the royal Holy King who descended from heaven to do the thing, to be the David. He was like being born to be a baby and to live the life that he lived. He's pictured in David facing the giant Goliath. Goliath being Satan or our sin. You want to pursue him to see him as that glorious hero, that David standing before Goliath, your sin, your bondage. And you want to savor this God so that when he comes, we're not shocked. Like, that is just not who I expected. The God you need to expect is the one who wants you to look to him in, through, and above all things as the radical center, like the root center of everything that you are, everything that you do, everything that you want, everything that you will be. Amen. Amen. Today we are going to celebrate the Lord's Supper, which is a wonderful thing. Our conversion to be united to God is pictured in the baptism ordinance. Us being united to Christ, to God through Christ, is pictured in our baptism ordinance. What's pictured then in the supper? Our ongoing reliance on our union with Christ. We've been given a new identity, a new nature, a new hope. We've been united to Christ. We're relying on him. That's what's pictured in the supper. Brothers, if you could please come to serve the elements. I'm just going to speak for a moment from John chapter 6. I think this is beautiful. Jesus speaking in John chapter 6, he's talking about himself as fulfilling things in the Old Testament, just like we talked about today, because he understood himself as the fulfillment of everything in the Old Testament. And he's talking about himself in terms of descending to the earth to meet our need and understanding himself as the fulfillment of the bread. So in the same way that the bread represents his body broken to give us life, sustenance, the wine represents his bloodshed, his death, his life substituted, sacrificed by God for God, for God's fulfillment of God's righteous requirement of the law. There must be a death. No one escapes without death. God never, ever, ever at any point just lets sin off the hook. We must die. And Jesus, what's pictured in both of those ordinances, is the fact that Jesus has come into the world to do what had to be done. There had to be death. There had to be bloodshed. Someone had to be broken because God is not a fool. He is just and righteous. So I'm going to, before we distribute the elements, when we distribute the elements, what we're going to do is we're going to meditate on what's pictured, that we have a union with Christ and that we must rely on him. We've been called to a calling. We weren't saved to go off and pursue anything else. We were saved to pursue this calling, this union that's pictured in the ordinances. And so when you take the elements, what we want to do, we're gonna have a song for each element to meditate. And you're going to meditate on, how well am I aligned with this? Is this my reality? Is this my new identity? Do I indeed know and believe and rely on the fact that I've been united to Christ in order to pass through God's righteous judgment? And now my life is not my own, but it is a gift to God, and I am part of the project to build His temple on earth, this church. Let me read for you Jesus speaking in John 6:33. For the bread of God is He who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Life to the world. And then in verse 41, so the Jews grumbled about Him because He said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. It seems so strange and offensive. In verses 50 and 51 of the same chapter, He said, this is the bread that comes down from heaven so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread, the provision from God that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. So He traded His flesh for our life. His life for our life. His life for your life. He is the bread that God provides. You don't need bread and drink to be sustained. What you really need is life everlasting. Because right now, we're all on a collision course with death. We're all dying. We're under a curse naturally. And we need the bread that is true life. And that is the sacrifice of Christ as our substitute. And finally, verse 58. This is the bread that came down from heaven. It's not like the bread the fathers ate in the wilderness and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. And that life, that forever life, starts right now in the way we pursue our calling to know and love God. You are the seed of eternity. In your heart is the beginning of the new creation. You are the temple of His presence, and you have this highest calling of all callings to pursue Him as your deepest treasure, to magnify Him in all things as we love each other because He first loved us. So now we're going to meditate on this and consider, maybe repent, how well we align with this reality that we've been united to Christ, and the only way we survive the judgment of God is because of our union with Christ. All right, please distribute the. take both elements. What I want to picture here is hold one element in each hand. We're holding on. So right now you have the wine. We're gonna distribute the element of the bread. What's pictured is you're holding on with both hands to this Savior. There's no halfway in. We're holding on with all that we got. We're relying entirely on this Savior. His life, his blood, his body broken, his blood shed. Now let's take the cup representing the blood of Christ, the Son of God, shed for us to wash away our sins, uniting us to Him. Thank you, Lord God, for your broken body and your shed blood, that you surrendered your life to be our substitute, to be a sacrifice in our place, to take the wrath of God that we deserved, and you took it willfully and with joy, looking past the shame of the cross to the glory of being our King who ascended to on high, to sit on the throne at the right hand of the Father, to rule the world for our good. Please help us, Lord, to understand our calling and to close with you, to be intimate with you and to pursue you, to know you and love you. In your name we pray. Amen. So thank you for celebrating the supper with us. As is traditional, we have a little hymn that gives, it's an invitation, it gives opportunity for people, anyone who's here joined with us who has heard the word and feels led by the Lord to surrender, to submit their life to Christ. Please feel free during this time to repent of anything that you've been struggling with, that maybe you haven't been aligning your life with your calling or your union with Christ, or to meditate on the Word of God today for a little bit. You can also come up and pray with me if you want to pray, just to surrender to the Lord and have me there with you to pray, or if you want to have some support, I'm here for you. Thank you for joining us to celebrate the Lord, to worship Him on this glorious Lord's Palm Sunday. Please join us if you can. Come back for our fellowship meal. Get to know us better. Support and love the people in the church the way God has loved you. And so may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God God the Father, and the comfort and fellowship of the Holy Spirit, who is also God, be with you this week as you are blessed knowing God has united you to himself, and you bless us and this world with the way you respond in love and mercy and humility and gratitude. Be blessed in the name of Christ. Amen.